I was speaking to Leonard Susskind on this podcast. I asked him about Many Worlds, and he said there are several technical questions that people who are believers in Many Worlds have, that I have toward them that they aren't able to answer. And he listed two that I recall. One was that branches in quantum theory can recombine. He said this whole notion of completely separate branches is, well, he questions that. We'll get to that. And then number two, he said, well, what about if you have, sure, you can have half a branch here, half a branch there, and the Born rule says 50%, 50%. But what if it's two branches and then one is one third and the other is two thirds? Yeah. Does the universe split into three and then irrational numbers and so on? So I know that these issues have been solved, or at least have answers and have had answers for decades.
Yes.
So my question is two parts. One, I would like you to actually answer those questions for people who are in the audience who are like, yeah, those sound like reasonable objections. But then number two, someone like Susskind, who's in the field of fundamental physics, he said they've never been able to answer this. So it's either that he's asking people who are rudimentary in Many Worlds theories, or he's not asking them, or he's not listening to them, or something like that. I don't know what's going on there. And I don't know if you see that as well with many of these people who are skeptics saying, look, they're never able to answer this. And you're like, I've had answers to these. You're just not listening. Or I guess that's a psychological question, which you perhaps don't want to go down. But
yeah,
either way, what is the answer to those two critical questions? We'll get to the psychoanalyzing question later.
So the one about probability.
Recombination of branches.
Recombination of branches. Well, this is going right back to Everett. One of the things that was kind of mistaken in Everett's view is that it regarded the, although he made the enormous bit of progress of regarding a measurement as a quantum process instead of regarding it as a structuralist classical process that gets an answer. So the measurement process is a process like any other, and then you see that there are superpositions of the observer as well as the system, and then you can see how the correlations happen and so on. However, although he analyzed the measurements that way, he analyzed the measurements in terms of what happened at the beginning and what happened at the end. He didn't actually ask what happens during the measurement at the time when the branches are forming.
You know how in physics we like to reduce something that's complex into something more elegant and more efficient, something simpler, for instance? It turns out you can do that with your dinner. HelloFresh sends you exactly the ingredients you need. They're pre-measured, they're pre-portioned, so you don't have to deal with this superposition of, do I have too much cilantro versus not enough cilantro, or whatever you have collapsing in your kitchen every night. They've just done their largest menu refresh yet, with literally 100 different recipes each week. There's vegetarian options, calorie smart ones, protein heavy, my personal favorite. Then there's a new steak and seafood options at no extra cost. All the meals take approximately 15 minutes to a half hour. They've actually tripled their seafood offerings recently and added more veggie-packed recipes. Each one has two or more vegetables now. I've been using it myself. It's the one experiment in my life that's always yielded reproducible results. It's delicious, it's easy, it saves me from having to live on just black coffee while editing episodes at 1 a.m. Personally, my favorite part is that it's an activity that I can do with my wife. Thus, it not only serves as dinner, but as a bonding exercise. The best way to cook just got better. Go to HelloFresh.com/TheoriesOfEverything10FM to get 10 free meals plus a free item for life. That's one per box with active subscription. Free meals applied as discounts on the first box, new subscribers only, varies by plan. That's HelloFresh.com/TheoriesOfEverything10FM to get 10 free meals plus a free item for life.
The branches are forming. And people later did that in the 1980s. I had a go at doing it in the late 70s and early 80s, and my my proposal was rubbish, but at least it kept me interested in the subject. And then some philosophers actually were the people that persuaded me of what the right answer is, which is that the branches are emergent properties. There's no branches don't appear in the fundamental theory. Instead of like in Everett's way of doing it, you had one world and then three worlds, let's say, or one world and a million worlds. Whereas what really happens is that there isn't really one world. It even when you have a single pure state of a system,
yes,
it's still the state of its being. Of a particle being at a particular place also includes within that unity, there is a diversity that the more the particle is in one place, the more its momentum is different. So there is no such thing as there being one world at the beginning. There's always a continuum of universes or worlds, but they're only worth calling universes when they subsequently evolve independently of each other. And typically that happens when there's been a measurement, in a measurement process. So before there's a measurement, when there's just a particle, a wave packet sitting there, yes, there's lots of momenta, there's lots of positions all happening at once. Nothing is ever sharp. But you can't say that there are different momenta in different universes because all those universes are interacting with each other. So you should only call something a universe when it is causally autonomous.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, it's behaving exactly as it would if the others were not there. And that's what happens after a measurement. So it's been a bit long-winded, but the answer is the rejoining of universes is what happens in an interference experiment. And during the interference experiment, you can't speak of universes because the different branches are affecting each other. Precisely, the interference is precisely the fact that that the different paths of a single photon around an interferometer. They're not behaving as if the other were not there. So when they come together, they do something completely different if the other one is there from what they would do if the other one weren't there. And that's the whole interference phenomenon. So the picture you can have in mind is that there's a continuum in some kind of entity that's a bit like space-time, but in Hilbert space or something.
Sure.
In the multiverse, which we don't know how to classify mathematically yet. But and then that continuum just differentiates itself into two. And as it's differentiating, there is no moment of split. What happens is that branch A is affecting branch B less and less. And when they have separated enough, like when you've made the measurement and you've copied it or something, then they're hardly affecting each other at all. They're affecting each other only to the level of 10 to the minus 10 to the 100 or something. So then you can speak of them, those things, as different universes. That's what happens after a measurement. And during interference, and also in the general case, you can't speak of universes. You can only speak of the multiverse and the multiplicity of values of things within the multiverse.